Everyone, this is Kellyanne Fitzpatrick from RedMonk here for a video on what is serverless observability and why does it matter, especially to developers. I have with me today Erica Windisch from New Relic, Andrew Tunnell from New Relic, and Danilo Paccio from Amazon Web Services, all of whom are experts at both serverless and observability. So we have a really great group of people here to talk about what is, you know, from our end, two concepts that we have heard about separately, certainly, but I think when you put them together, we get something, you know, particularly exciting and fabulous. So first, I'd like to ask, Danilo, can you tell us a little bit about what you are seeing with your customers and the developers who work for them in terms of the shift from architectures from monoliths to, say, microservices or serverless?
Well, what I'm seeing is that in the past, there were these very large monolithic applications that were lots of developers, like tens, hundreds of developers were working on a single project. Now I'm seeing that customers are adopting, especially as they grow, smaller services and microservices. This is actually something that we also did in Amazon around 2001, 2002. So even before the term microservices was used. And this is really allowing them to, in a way, work on a more focused project and in an independent way. So probably the most important feature of microservices is that you can deploy them independently, so you don't need to wait for someone else before you release a new version.
That sounds like a big plus for developers.
Yeah. And one of the reasons why microservices work, in my opinion, is really the law of our universe. Because in the last 30 years, there's been a new kind of science that has been developed, the complexity science, that is quite interesting because it's going across lots of different fields from mathematics, physics, but also biology, social science. And when we look at complex complexity, for example, in weather forecasting or anything that is complex to understand for our brain, we find that this complexity comes because there are dependencies across components that can also be simple. So this is, I think, is very relevant for software development, because when you have a large monolithic application, you have a large code base, and every time you try to change something here, you have an unplanned side effect in another part of your application there. So as the application grows, it becomes more and more complex to update your application without creating side effects. So you can be very, very thorough with how you develop your software architecture modules. But with microservices, it's much easier because you can create clear boundaries across the services. And then inside each service, you can develop them, and then you don't create dependencies because you have to go through the service interface to talk with the other services.
Yeah. Well, can you tell us a bit more about what does this actually mean for the types of like architectures that you're seeing your customers actually using?
So the side effect is that these multiple services and microservices that we see being developed are actually using different platforms. So this is, I think, another plus for developers because they don't have to stick to the company programming language that is used to be something like Java.NET for the rest of their programming life. But now they can use a different programming platform for each service. They use the better one, so they can use Rust if it makes sense because it's a low-level service and they need memory protection. They can use Go if they want speed. They can use Python if there's data science. And all these components are also deployed in different ways. So if we look into actually the underlying architecture in the next slide, we see that some of this is deployed in containers, some of this is fully managed databases or services. We still have virtual machines, but we're starting to see customers using more and more functions like that you can tie to events, and this can trigger your business logic. So this serverless adoption is really simplifying a lot when you start to have lots of different modules.
Yeah, and this kind of move to more managed services, like what type of implications does that have?
Oh, well, the side effect is that if you have a single monolithic application, it's relatively easy to understand if it's working or not. But if you have tens or even hundreds of microservices, then it starts to be difficult to understand what is happening inside. So the big change, especially from a developer perspective, in my opinion, is that with microservices and with serverless, you should make what is happening inside your application clear to the outside world. So you should, it's really a developer responsibility to build a visibility into what is happening inside each of the modules that you develop.
So more responsibility for developers and observability is now on their plate. But what is it that we actually mean when we say observability? So this is a term that I've heard a lot, but some developers are probably like, what is this? Why do I need to care about it? But tell us more.
Yeah, actually, the best definition that I found, it's on Wikipedia. So normally not the best place to find a reliable source in general. But I really like this definition. And it actually, what happens with observability, it actually the first time we start to use this term, it was in control theory. So in the same way, when if you rise the temperature of your thermostat at home, you want to understand, you want a feedback if the change you made is working, so the temperature is increasing or lowering as expected. This is something similar to what happens with software applications. If you do a change, if you get an input, you want to understand if this is being processed correctly with the expected performance. So this is really the idea of observability. And with software architecture, normally there's what commonly we call the three pillars of observability. So from every component of your application, you should be able to get logs that describe what this application are doing internally, metrics that give you a quantitative understanding of what this application are doing, so the number of transactions processed per minute or the amount of CPU or memory that are being used. And probably the most important one for every distributed architecture is tracing. So the possibility of correlating the activities of all these different components and understanding the flow of the data across the your microservices-based architecture.
Yeah, that's great. And that's probably one of the most briefest definitions of observability I have heard of late. So thank you for that. So I feel that we've just kind of covered a lot of ground in terms of definitions and what we mean when we're saying, you know, certain things and why developers should care about this concept of observability. I want to kind of, you know, shift focus a little bit. Erica, I was hoping you could tell us a little bit about the challenges that serverless and observability, kind of bring.
Yeah, absolutely. I've been building serverless applications for 4 or 5 years now. And I think that serverless itself has also changed a lot. Just this most recent reInvent, Lambda Destinations was announced. And I think that changes the distributed tracing story quite a bit as well, right? So, these observability challenges in some ways are becoming greater as the platform becomes more capable and enables us to wire together more things. It does solve a number of old and existing problems. Otherwise, nobody would be making that transition. There's no cost for idle. When there's no traffic, there's no cost to run those, to keep those Lambda functions available. Operations, it's highly scalable and secure. In terms of scalability, you're not locked to a single server. It auto scales automatically. And it's not like container or virtual machine auto scaling, which was a slow and kind of I want to say kind of brittle process of auto scaling those services. Lambda can scale per request if needed. It can actually spawn new resources and containers per each request if desired, or of course it can reshare those containers, and it's a higher level abstraction, right? And precisely as I was describing a scalability, because it's a higher level of abstraction, as a developer, you're not directly dealing with the architecture, the containers, the virtual machines. You're building code and you're shipping it. You can realize things like GitOps with serverless and just operate at the higher level of abstraction. But the higher level of abstraction is all now application-based rather than infrastructure-based.
So that was kind of, I think, a great overview of some of the problems that serverless solves. And I really love the emphasis on the developer being able to be like, I have built my code and I ship it and I do not have to worry about all these other things. Like that just makes me happy to hear that. But clearly, there's probably some issues that are now introduced with this new way of, architecting apps.
Absolutely. So when you're building a serverless application, you're building a stateless distributed app. You need to build those applications to be distributed and to be relatively stateless, at least within the Lambda function code, because otherwise, that's how you realize these benefits of scalability and being able to deploy on this platform that allows you to scale and allows you to build securely. But that means a possibility of lots more invocations, right? Rather than looking at a server or a service that's running on the machine, you're looking at many different invocations and web requests. And so you're getting that deep, granular, highly correlated data, but there's so much more of that data now because we're surfacing so much of it. And I think that can be a challenge if you don't have the right tools, right? It's distributed, lots of data. The persistent context across observability systems can also be a problem. If you, a lot of these tools aren't really correlating that data across tools. We can definitely do it within tools inside of a larger platform like New Relic. And it can require a lot of manual work to integrate observability between traditional apps and serverless apps, at least not without the right tools. And I think that serverless also creates this combination of challenges, also opportunity, right? Because we're now bringing your infrastructure into your application. You're only building the application. You're only worrying about the application side, but the infrastructure comes along for the ride. And that means that your business metrics, your business insights, your application insights and observability, as well as your infrastructure, which was not originally a developer concern for a lot of developers, but was a different unit inside of your organization, is now kind of brought into the scope of your application. And very often you don't need to worry about these operational details, but sometimes you do. So you need a platform that, like the architecture that it's observing, is able to correlate and be highly correlated with all of this data across these different vectors, across infrastructure, application, and business metrics, logic, insights.
Yeah, no, that was great. So that was, again, a very, I think, succinct, like, here are some of the challenges with serverless and observability. What is it the developers actually need in order to kind of help address these types of challenges? Andrew, I was hoping that you could tell us a bit about how New Relic specifically is helping developers, kind of address these challenges and adapt as serverless itself keeps changing and growing.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a great place to kind of get started with that is the tenets that we use when we're thinking about serverless observability in our tools. I think the first is, you shouldn't need to use lots of tools to get the answer you want. Erica briefly touched on, this notion of correlation, but imagine a world where you're using a different tracing tool from a different kind of raw event store, from a metric generation tool, from a log tool. Now you're having to do a lot of work to tie all these data sources together and kind of hope that you created the right level of data in each data source. I tend to prefer systems that are that get me the answers that function of intention rather than luck. So, if we can create systems that automatically do the correlation for you or make it trivial for you to get to the data you want, that really, for developers, if you're in an operational mode, will help mean time to resolution or to detect, or even in the development process, be really valuable. The next two things I think are really related, which is that we take an approach where we favor high cardinality. And so we actually, New Relic's interesting in that we've had a really high scale event system, not in terms of the event driven architecture system that triggers something like a Lambda function, but in terms of how we think of a atomic point in time capture of data. And so we capture an individual invocation with lots of these kind of high level categorized metrics. And I think about them from the perspective of organizing your brain's mental model, right? If you, when we created traditional metric systems around monoliths, we kind of said like, here are the front doors to your house, and we'll tell you whether or not the front door is locked or not, or whether it's broken. But you know, as you correlate all these functions that have many front doors, you need that same level of granularity and association. The problem is that, and Danilo talked about this, the raw trace data is super valuable information. It gets you exactly what's happening within those invocations. But from your brain's ability to actually organize that data and say, this is the category of thing that is breaking across the set of functions, it's actually quite difficult. I mean, you look at a function that might make a bunch of reads off a Kinesis stream, it's not going to be helpful for your brain to see lots and lots of requests and trying to organize exactly where a problem's happening. So we kind of take these generic attributes that we tag to an event, and then we correlate it to all of the really raw data, like traces and like logs. We also favor like automatic instrumentation. So, you know, we realize that not every developer has the time to learn open standards. And for some of them, for many of our SDKs, we support open standards as a alternate tool set for the developers who want to do it. But we also provide tools to do a lot of the heavy lifting for you, so you get some goodness out of the box. Maybe you didn't build the code that you've inherited, even if it is relatively new. And so getting the answer so that you can effectively operate it or optimize for performance is pretty critical. And then I'll talk about this in a little bit, but you know, when we talk about these black boxes kind of surrounding the things that maybe you can't control being a black box, even, you know, Amazon S3, amazing service. It's arguably a first true like serverless service that was, you know, introduced to the internet. You don't really know what's causing GET request or PUT request latency without data from both your custom app or your client that's making the request, as well as the actual underlying metric data that Amazon provides. And then finally, we think that like a link to be able to actually create business specific information and do that correlation is pretty critical, as well as access to a whole lot of platform features that you don't have to use other tool sets for. So, you know, creating custom dashboards across various types of things in your system or alert ties in as well.
Yeah, insights is another word that we're hearing a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's funny, like New Relic has a product called Insights, but I think, you know, when we talk to like Red Monk about Insights, the question is like, how do I understand the impact of what's happening within my system relative to the data that I have? Yeah. And so, you know, I think our approach is like, we take those three pillars that Danilo referenced, the log data, which you can log information through, metrics, which we actually... So we generate metrics on a per request basis for something like AWS Lambda, and that's highly atomic information that allows you to actually do some really interesting things in kind of tying, let's say, performance degradation to business insights. And the reason is, if you're able to, you know, I know kind of traditionally, right, we've provided a what's the average duration of a request or what's the average latency. P50 data is actually not really that interesting. Everyone's P100 looks horrible. Everyone's P0 looks great. And everyone's P50 probably also looks fine. It's when you're, you know, at P70, 30% of your customers could be experiencing an outsized impact. So if you're seeing degradation due to third-party systems at high load, it's probably not affecting your average as much. That's not going to look as alarming as if I go look at the P70 and say, oh, 30% of my customers are actually having a really bad time. And if I can say, okay, at the P70 or the P90 or the P39s, the 99.9th percentile, across a million requests a minute, that actually could have a very explicit impact to, let's say, order conversion or some sort of processing activity. And so, you know, when we talk about gaining insights to what the correlation is, we want to say, okay, we have this raw data where we can start asking really interesting questions. How do we actually also go save data that's meaningful to me in business context, or in the context of, you know, specific error diagnosis? And I mentioned, you know, we've for quite a few years now had this really high scale kind of atomic event data store. You know, whether it's data about what actually drove a series of serverless requests, whether it's data about kind of your business implications, whether it's data about custom error analysis or downstream payload information that's meaningful to you, you're able to take kind of that data and correlate it to all of those underlying data types that are really part of the three pillars, you know, the traces, the high cardinality event data, which we synthesize metrics from, and the underlying logs. So we think like all of that together gives you that really 360 view of what's happening within your system. You're able to kind of infer what the impact is from various data points across the system.
Yeah, so, you know, a lot of things to take in, and, you know, New Relic certainly, you know, helping developers like figure out what to do with all of that. Just like observability itself is dealing with a lot of ingestion of information. I feel like we took in a lot of information, you know, today. We covered what is serverless and observability, what are the challenges that it brings, and how can New Relic help developers specifically navigate them. So I hope you all found that useful. I'd like to thank, you know, our presenters, you know, today. Thank you very much for joining us.